Good morning, students. Today we are going to discuss about introduction to genomics and proteomics, terminologies and history. So it is a topic in your course BT 3515, and this course is about 3 credits only theory credit and 0 practical credits. So it is a lecture number 1, and it is topic already we mentioned, and it is of weightage 2%. So let's see the contents. So in contents, we are going to discuss about introduction to genomics, and in that importance of genomics and genomics history. Then in next lecture we are going to discuss about introduction to proteomics. What is proteomics, its importance and its workflow, how we isolate the protein, then broad-based proteomics, proteomics history, and I'm going to give some additional information about some crops and its genomics. So let's see definition of genomics. So genomics is the interdisciplinary field of biology, and it is focusing on the genome structure, function, evolution, the mapping and editing of genomes. So we know that genome is a complete set of DNA. And we know that on DNA we have genes. So in briefly, a genome is an organism's complete set of DNA, including all the genes of organisms. So let's say in human, we have about 1 lakh of genes. But at a time, these 1 lakh genes do not transcribe, they do not code for protein. About 20 to 25,000 genes only they code for protein. So we can call those genes as a functional genes. So, but if you want to talk about genome, we can consider as a 1 lakh genes is a genome of a human. But there is also another term, like genetics. So it is a study of individual gene and their inheritance. But in genome, we consider all the genes. Genome, how we know about genome? So we get to know about genome from its sequencing. So we know that in DNA we have ATGC base pairs. So to know the genome, to know the genes, we should know the sequence. So genomics also involve the history or the pattern of the genes, their sequences. So the term genomics was coined by the Tom Frederick in 1986. The study of genomics is diverse into other branches such as comparative genomics. So the terms is self-explanatory. So information of one genome is used for mapping position and function of genes in second genome. So if we know the sequence or genes of one genome, we can compare that genome with another genome and we can know the functions of genes by comparing them, two genomes. Then another term is functional genomics. So identifying all the genes in genome and determine their expression pattern and functions. It is called as functional genomics. Let's see next slide. So we know that when genome term got popularized, it popularized when our human genome project started, and it was started in 1986 and it was completed in 2003. So when the human genome project completed and all the human genes or genome was put before the public domain, So everybody started talking about the genes, genomes, and also the research on the genomes and genes actually started. So today, so how human genome project started? It was started with very basic sequencing techniques, like Fred Sanger group established a technique of sequencing in 1970. We're going to see in detail in next slides about that. So today, next generation sequencing technology are used, and it has reduced the cost of gene sequencing, and also it has reduced the time of sequencing. So we previously, so how many years it took in, from 1986 up to 2003? So it took many years, but now the sequencing technologies are very advanced, and in within 2 or 3 days you can sequence a gene of an organism, any organism. So if you see some statistics of human genome, we know that human has 46 chromosomes. Then if you measure the length of DNA, it is about 2 meters of length. We have 3 billion DNA subunits, that is 80 GC, and approximately 30,000 genes code for protein that perform most of the life function. So there is a statistics of human genome. Then in next slide, we are going to see genome sequencing. So we are going to see some history, how it actually, who started the sequencing and what was the method we used. So the sequencing started with the sequencing techniques. So it used to call as the first generation DNA sequencers, because they were very basic. And in 1977, actually 2 landmark articles on DNA sequencing were published. And with these 2 articles, these 2 research, actually DNA sequencing, idea came into mind of scientists, and later it resulted into human genome project. So scientist Fredrik Sanger has invented a technique, enzymatic dideoxy DNA sequencing technique, based on, you know, that chain termination dideoxynucleotide analogs. Other scientists, Alan Maxim and Walt Gilbert, they also invented one technique, chemical degradation DNA sequencing technique, in which a terminally labeled DNA fragment were chemically cleaved at specific base and separated by gel electrophoresis. So these 2 basic techniques many scientists started to use, and when time passed, so many scientists, many big companies, they invented many different techniques of DNA sequencing. So those techniques, it was used to call as high throughput next generation sequencing. And after some time, many sequencing techniques upgraded, and we used to call them second generation high throughput next generation sequencing, then third generation HT-NGS. We are going to see which were those methods. So you can see in the diagram, you can see the first generation sequencers, as we already discussed, Fredrik Sanger and Alan Maxa. Then in 2000, many big companies came into the picture, and they gave birth to the HT-NGS, that is high throughput next generation sequencing. Then Jonathan Rothberg founded a company, that is 454 Life Science, which further developed the first commercially available NGS platform, the GS20. Then after that, second generation HT-NGS platform came, and there were some companies that is like Roche, biosequencing chemistry, it is based on biosequencing chemistry, then Solid, then Illumina. After that, third generation STNGS platform came and it was very advanced with minimum time and minimum cost they used to sequence the DNA. So there are few companies, Heliscope, then Smart, SNAP, Nanopore DNA sequencers, then real-time single molecule DNA sequencers, then ion torrent sequencing technology. And also today there are many upgradation are going on in case of next generation sequencing. So we know that for sequencing we have some kind of procedure. So first of all, if you want to sequence a DNA, we know that DNA is present in the cell. So genomic DNA first, we have to extract from a sample of cell of an organism, and then we have to break it into random fragments. These fragments, when we get these fragments, we clone in a DNA vector. We call this carrier. That is capable of carrying large inserts. For example, BAC, it is bacterial artificial chromosome, which carry the large fragments. So after cloning these DNA fragments into a vector, then each of the clone fragment is amplified individually by replication inside a living bacteria, which produces rapidly and great quantity of generate mini bacterial clones. So when it gets replicated, our gene of interest or our DNA fragment also get replicated. So the clone DNA is then extracted from bacterial clones and is fed into the sequencing machine. So question might come that why we want to clone it and why we want to replicate it. So the answer is that we want many copies of that particular fragment, because one fragment we cannot view for sequencing. We need millions of copies of that fragment, so can feed it to the sequencer and then sequencer can sequence it. So when we feed it into a sequencing machine, then the resulting sequence data is stored in a computer and computer ties them together using sequence overlap. So when sequencing happens, there are many overlaps, and then computer do the statistics analysis and they match the overlapping sequence, and the result is the genomic sequence, which is then deposited in a public accessible database. So any scientist, any human can see that sequence and they can use it. So this is a general procedure for genome sequencing. So this procedure will help to know the genes and genome of an organism. So you can see here two kind of sequencing approach scientist has used when they started the human genome. So one approach was used by a company which was private organization. In that time, when human genome started, at that time two players are working on the human genome. So one player was Celera Genomics, which was a private company, and another was a government or public funded project which was run by government, and then we call it Human Genome Project. So they used two different approaches. So Celera Genomics used shotgun fragmentation or shotgun approach, but the Human Genome Project used back-to-back approach. That is, they use bacterial artificial chromosome to clone the DNA. So, but the result of these two methods was same, that we used to get a sequence of gene. But the shotgun approach was very fast, and it was it gave the result very fast. But later, the Celera Genomics started publishing their sequence in public domain. Also, the Human Genome Project, which was government funded, also started publish their sequence in the public domain. And after some time, they came together and they found that their gene sequence are matching. And in 2003, both the parties came together and they published the human genome publicly. So now we are going to see what is the importance of genomics. So why we want to study genomics, or why we want to sequence the genome? So we want to know what is missing from the genome. So when we sequence the gene, or we sequence the genome, when we compare that genome with other genome, other organisms' genome, or same person compare it his genome with another person, then we come to know what is missing in that. What is missing? Then we identify genes, pathways that are difficult to study biochemically. Then we find every gene that is in the pathway of interest. Pathway means, we know that in biochemistry we have different cycles, like TCA cycles, glycolysis. And in that cycle we have many enzymes. So we know that enzymes are proteins. So, when from where protein come, they come from gene through transcription, then translation. Then, so we want to know which gene codes for which protein. Then we study non-coding region of genome by using genomics. So there are coding region of in human genome, or in eukaryotic genome. There are coding region, non-coding regions. So, like introns, exons. We want to study promoters. We want to study telomeres. Then, by studying the genome, it provides large database that are amenable to statistical methods. So, we can use statistics methods. So, identify variant sequence that may have subtle phenotypes. Then, study evolution of organism and genomes. So, these are all the points which give the importance. So this importance, actually it is a very helpful for scientists actually to know why we want to sequence the genome. So as an agriculture scientist, you might question, what is the useful of genomics in agriculture? So in agriculture, we know that the main area or main objective of any agriculture practices is to develop a new varieties. So to develop a new varieties, we should have a genes which can give a different properties to a new cultivar or new variety. So for example, we want a plant, it should be a very resistant to biotic and abiotic stresses. We need a plant which can resistant to insects. We need a plant which can sustain the pathogen attack. We need a plant which is a salinity tolerant. So all these traits we need in a plant. So whenever environmental conditions are very harsh, that plant can survive. So for that, we need a genetic resource of that plant. Then from genetic resource, how we can get a genetic resource? From sequencing. We sequence that plant's genome. Then we study the gene expression analysis. Then when we have a genome of that plant in hand, we can use two approach. We can use gene cloning, which is a shortcut, and within 1 or 2 years we can develop a cultivar or variety Or another approach is marker development, or we can say marker assisted selection. So we have to search for a marker for a particular gene, and with that marker we can do a breeding, and through breeding it takes 5 to 10 years to develop variety with marker assisted selection, and then we can do a particular selective breeding and we get new cultivar. So another shortcut is gene cloning. So we identify different genes. For example, we identify gene for abiotic and biotic stress. We identify gene for particular resistant to particular pathogen, particular insect, or salinity tolerant gene. And all of these genes we then clone into that organism or in that plant. So we transfer all those genes, resistant gene, into plant, and that plant then develop into a new improved cultivar. So this is the importance of genomics in agriculture. So next point in our genomics topic is a history of genomics. So it is very interesting to know the history, because the genomic history actually started from the invention of DNA sequence. So we know that who invented the DNA sequence. But before that invention of DNA sequence, actually in 1971, Frederick Mitchell, he first published a paper, and he named the DNA as a nucleon, an associated protein in cell nucleus. So it was started in 1971. Then in 1904, Walter Sutton and Theodore Fauzi, they put forward the chromosome theory of heredity. They thought that the chromosomes are inherited in next generation. That is inherited from mother, father to their son. Then in 1910, Albert Kossel, he got the Nobel Prize, and because of his work on discovery of 5 nucleotides, that is ATGC, and also uracil. Then in 1950, Erwin Chargaff worked out on pairing pattern. So Erwin, we called Chargaff rule, that is A pair with T and G pair with C. Then in 1952, Hersha Chase, this is a very famous experiment carried out by Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase, and they demonstrated that DNA is a genetic material, not protein. Then in 1953, a very famous experiment or invention done by James Watson and Francis Crick, and they discovered the DNA double helix with contribution from Rosalind Franklin and Maurice Wilkins. Then in 1961, Marshall Lindbergh and Hargobind Khurana, they broke the code, and they code, we know that codon. So three letters code for a particular amino acid. Then in 1968, Lindbergh and Hargobind Khurana got a Nobel Prize because of their cracking the genetic code. Then in 1977, Frederick Sanger, we already seen that they discovered the DNA sequencing technique. Also, Maxim Gilbert gave the DNA sequencing technique. Then in 1980, Fred Sanger received the Nobel Prize for the pioneering the DNA sequencing technique. Then in 1983, we discovered the gene responsible for Huntington's disease. Then in 1985, Alec Jeffrey He actually worked on the DNA profiling and he produced the counting of number. Counting means the repetitive sequence in the DNA. So we know that in DNA, there is a repetition of sequence. That's why we have vast number of genes, that is 1 lakh. But out of that 1 lakh, only 25,000 genes are active, because many region on the genome is repetitive. In 1988, Francis Collins, they found the location of three important disease genes on human genome, that is cystic fibrosis, Goethe muscular dystrophy, and Huntington's disease. They found actually location of these genes on the genome. Then in 1990, Human Genome Project started. So after 15 years, in 2003, so the project aimed to sequence all the 3 billion letters of a genome in 15 years. So in 2003, they published the human sequence, human genome. So in 1992, then two American scientists worked on testing of embryos. So what was the importance of testing the embryos? So we get to know if the embryo has any kind of disease or any kind of gene which can cause the disease in the future. In 1995, the first bacterium genome sequence completed. That is Haemophilus influenza. In 1996, an interesting international team completed the sequence of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and first clone animal, that is the leadership, was born. Then in 1998, they published the genome of C. elegans, which is a model organism for study the genomics. In 2000, full genome of Drosophila melanogaster was completed. In 2001, first draft of genome sequence released. So in 2002, a mouse genome was sequenced. We know that the human genome and mouse genome is about 85% similar. In 2005, chimpanzee genome completed, and we know that the 96% of chimp genes are similar with the human genome. In 2007, a DNA sequencing technology introduced, that is, we call it as a next generation sequencing, and it was very fast, with 70-fold. And in within 1 year, they found out many genomes of many organisms. In 2008, next generation sequencing platform resulted in dramatic drop in sequencing cost. And at last, in 2013, zebrafish genome completed. So this is a history of genomics. How we started with knowing that the nucleus, that is a nucleus, it has a some kind of material which codes for the which code for a DNA, which code for some sequence, and after that we get to know the what is that DNA, and after that we at 2003 we sequence the zebrafish genome. So it is a very long journey, that is history of genomics. So with this, we conclude this lecture, and in next lecture, we are going to see what is proteomics. So like genomics, we define genomics as a set of all genes. Like that, in case of proteomics, we call it as set of all the proteins of an organism, which does various functions. So it is also an interesting topic. So for today, we end here. Thank you.